Hi everyone, this is Sira and you're watching Tech Fulladites. One of the major differences between developed countries and ours is the pattern of energy use. They use a lot more to fuel their decadent lifestyles. And if we're to become the golden bird of the world again, we need to generate and consume a lot more power too. I know the fashionable thing to say nowadays is that we need to scale down our consumption of energy, live more sustainably, etc. But that's not going to happen. Neither China nor us are going to sacrifice development at the altar of carbon. Currently, we depend on coal to produce the bulk of our energy. And that's not great. Whether you care about climate change or not, the quality of air we breathe affects everyone. But what if I told you that one of our great sages had peered through the mists of time and given us a blueprint for clean, plentiful energy? Let's talk physics. This is a uranium-235 atom. It's quite big and unwieldy and has two major forces acting on it. The strong force which attracts neutrons and protons together, and the electromagnetic force which repulses protons away. This strong force has a very limited area of influence. So when uranium-235 reaches out to grab a neutron, the electrostatic force rips it down the middle. The fission products zip away from each other at 3% of the speed of light. The process also creates three additional neutrons. In order that they don't fly away, we have to slow them down. And this is accomplished by surrounding the fuel with water. These slow neutrons then fizz other uranium-235 atoms. The process repeats and we have a chain reaction on our hands. And remember how temperature just means kinetic energy of particles? Well, the fuel starts to heat up and this heat is carried away by the water to generate steam. The steam turns a turbine and the turbine fairy then creates electricity. This process is used in almost every nuclear plant around the world. The only problem is that uranium-235 comes along with non-fissile uranium-238, which constitutes 99.3% of the mix. So we have to enrich uranium-235 to around 3% to be able to use it with regular water. In India, we decided we didn't want to go through that process, so we use heavy water instead of light water, which got us and our friends in trouble with the United States a couple of times. But that's a different story. India has another problem. We only have 2% of the world's reserves of uranium. And remember, only 0.7% of it is the good stuff. We do, however, have a lot of thorium. Almost a third of the world's total supply is to be found in the form of monazite in the sands of Kerala. Thorium is not fissile, but it is fertile. When you bombard it with a neutron, it undergoes beta decay twice to become uranium-233, which, you guessed it, is fissile. This kind of reactor is called a breeder reactor because it produces more fissile material than you initially started with. The fact that thorium cannot be used for nuclear weapons is great because it means we can make nuclear energy universally available. In fact, when I heard the news that the North Koreans hacked into our systems to extract information about thorium power, I was like, why don't we just give it to them? There are many types of reactors being designed and tested that run on thorium. The most exciting amongst which are the molten salt reactors. In conventional reactors, the water has to operate at 200 to 300 degrees Celsius. And because water boils at 100 degrees, it has to be kept under high pressure with pumps to maintain it in a liquid state. If the pumps fail, the water will expand suddenly, flash into steam, and lead to an explosion. MSRs avoid this because the salt can remain liquid up to temperatures of 2 to 3000 degrees Celsius. So this removes the need for high pressures. There are also intrinsic safety features, like a plug of frozen salt, which melts when the reactor overheats and drains the fuel into storage tanks where the reaction will stop. They could also help us solve the water crisis for good by allowing for cheap desalination of seawater. There are quite a few drawbacks to this technology for now. The molten salts that act as fuels cause corrosion in the tubes, which is a problem because then they need to be replaced. And for that, the reactor would have to be shut down. But we seem to be developing countermeasures against this. From simply using thicker tubes to different materials to trying to reduce the oxidation properties of the molten salt. I'm going to link some articles below for you to catch up on the current state of progress. The biggest reason though is economic. Uranium is very cheap. I could buy a couple of cages of it from what this channel earned just last month. In the meantime, there are several other plants planned. We're finally beginning to use light water reactors, the main benefit of which is that they are well understood. We have agreements with multiple countries to supply us with uranium. A lot of people worry about nuclear waste, but we already have adequate methods of dealing with it. And if we can make it to the thorium age, the nuclear waste will be a hundredth of what is generated by uranium-235. What are the other arguments against nuclear energy? Well, the major one is the risk of Chernobyl-like disasters. That cannot happen today as modern reactors have containment buildings. Well, what if terrorists fly a plane into it? Good question. The plane will disintegrate. What about using the fuel to create weapons? Can't happen. You need to enrich the fuel to 85% uranium-235 for it to be weapons grade. And if you can enrich uranium, well, you can get uranium from anywhere. It's in the very soil you're standing on. You don't need to get it from nuclear fuel. We need to give nuclear energy an image makeover. I mean, look at this. I can feel my DNA breaking down just by looking at this picture. Instead of nuclear power, can we just call it fission energy? It avoids most of the negative connotations around nuclear weapons and sounds nice and clean, like you're on a silent lake. Fission. And this ridiculous symbol? Let's replace it with a clover. We'll import some from Canada and plant them all around nuclear reactors. What about the colors? This kawaii color palette should go a long way towards ensuring that people feel more secure around fission plants. Let's also make these cooling towers works of art so that they add to the landscape instead of looking vaguely foreboding. So are we ready to usher in a new golden age of thorium-based nuclear energy in our country? It is there if we want it. The things I think may hold us back is a romance for solar and wind energy. I think they're a big part of our future, but they do not provide the consistent power that civilization needs to thrive. The hardest thing we have to do sometimes is to be rational despite the feeling in our gut. In human interactions, our instincts serve us well. But in matters of science and policy, an objective look at the evidence is often the path to prosperity. As the world increasingly looks to decarbonize, nuclear technology is our best bet for cleaner air and a safer planet. If you're interested further in this topic, there are links in the description where you can learn a lot more. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Like, share, subscribe, and start a conversation below to get more videos like this in your recommendations. I'll see you really soon. Bye.